Good morning, everyone. Welcome. Hate to break up a good party, but we're going to start worshiping the Lord right now. We're going to all find a seat and stand together.
I feel warm.
Chains fell off, and they could walk free, and they stay with the jailer who's ready to commit suicide because of that. Them being able to go free and say, "No, we're all here," and just how that really relates to us and the bondage we are, that we have in our sin, And Christ has caused those chains to fall off, if we'll accept that. Oh, I pray that we all accept that. Now let's pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for the salvation that you give us. What tremendous blessing that is. What a gift that is really unfathomable for us to really comprehend. But it's true, it's you. And it is a life everlasting that you provide us with. But Lord, as we can look forward to that, as we can build in that faith that you provide for us, that you give us, that you grow in us, Lord, we also have the challenges of the day, of the week. You know, our community is hurting, Lord, not knowing where Ralph Brown is, a beloved member of our community. And Lord, it impacts us. So Lord, we pray that he will be found, that he will be found safe. But Lord, we pray for a resolution to his missing. Lord, we also have plenty of hurting just within our own congregation, in our own lives. Lord, we want to lift that up to you, trust you with that. Lord, we do now just open our hearts, impact us with your word. Help us to see the truths that you have for us. We ask this in your name. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. All right. Well, I want to encourage you to enjoy and cherish your Memorial Day. I was hit with the thought today, you know, I was reading over our passage for today, which is 2 Kings chapter 14, isn't it?
14.
Yeah, chapter 14, verses 23 through 29, we're studying about Jeroboam II, who was king of Israel. Okay, we can easily get lost in all these names, but you know, all these kings of Israel, of Judah that we've been studying, they're all ancestors of Jesus, of Christ on earth. So there's significance to that. But, you know, as we come into Memorial Day, we remember those who have come before us, those who have fought, you know, for our nation and such. It hit me, you know, how far back, how well do we actually remember? Here we have a biblical record of this lineage, you know, and it was so important, you know, to be recorded. And how many of you can give me the first names of all of your great-grandparents? Yeah, I was struggling with that this morning. Good job. But I'm like, no, I can tell you some of them, but I can't tell you all of them. I can tell you Cordy Marble, that's one of them. But if we go by last names, I'm doing pretty good. But no, you know, it's how easily, you know, it can be forgotten. So cherish the memories of those who have come before you. You wouldn't be here now if it wasn't for them. So anyway, I've taken a lot of time on that. I did tell you what we're studying next week. No, I told you what we're studying today. Next week and the weeks following, you know what? I've been up here having enough words with and exchanges, somewhat humorous, with Bob. I finally just printed it up. It's on the back table there by Janelle. If you want a copy of what we're studying, so you read ahead, I encourage you to do that. It's a blessing to be able then to hear the sermon and follow along. There's youth tonight at 6 p.m., and then you have an event on Saturday, right?
Yes.
Laser tag, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, so I'm trusting those of you in the youth already know the details on that, but Matt will remind you further what friends and what expense that will incur as well. And June 13th, we want to recognize our seniors graduating from school. Seniors, not people my age and older, but those of you who are accomplishing graduating from your classes. And then Tuesday evening, you can join us elders for prayer on Zoom. If you want a link to that, see me after church. Bless you, Matt. and again. And then blanket coverage, we're off for this month, but be looking at July and see what dates you have available to fill those. And then finally, our prayer cards and visitor cards are at the back table. It really is a privilege to pray for one another. And not only do we want to be a Bible church studying God's word, we want to be a praying church too. So let us know how we can be praying for you. With that said, maintain your social distancing as appropriate, as you're aware of your own situation, and greet one another. You know, it's a privilege to be able to do that, isn't it? Okay, well, you can do it sometime.
Beautiful one I love, beautiful one I adore, beautiful one my soul must sing. As one. So the scripture reading for today is from the book of 2 Kings, chapter 14, verses 23 through 29. I learned a neat little trick today that sometimes it's hard to find your spot in the Bible, but if you take it and you cut it in half, you get somewhere close to Psalms. And if you cut it a half again, you get somewhere towards the end of the Pentateuch, and if you cut that here so that you have 3/8, you get right where we are. At least it works in my book. So that gives you a general idea of where we are. First 3/8 of the Bible. So again, we're chapter 14 of 2 Kings 23 through 29. In the 15th year of Amaziah, son of Joash, king of Judah, Jeroboam, the son of Joash, king of Israel, became king in Samaria, and he reigned for 41 years. He did evil in the eyes of the Lord, and did not turn away from any of the sins of Jeroboam, son of Nebat, which he had caused Israel to commit. He was the one who restored the boundaries of Israel from Libo Hatma, or Hamath, to the Dead Sea, in accordance with the word of the Lord. And God of Israel spoke through his servant Jonah of Amittai, the prophet from Gath-Hepher. The Lord had seen how bitterly everyone in Israel, whether slave or free, was suffering, and there was no one to help them. And since the Lord had not said that he would blot out the name of Israel from under heaven, he saved them by the hand of Jeroboam, son of Joash. As for the other events of Jeroboam's reign, all he did and his military achievements, including how he recovered for Israel, both Damascus and Hamath, which had belonged to Judah, are they not written in the books of the annals of the kings of Israel? Jeroboam rested with his ancestors, the kings of Israel, and Zechariah, his son, succeeded him as king. God's word for God's people.
Thanks be to God.
And the children are dismissed.
So this king, we know right off by what scripture says that he did evil in the sight of the Lord, correct? So, is that a good thing, to do evil in the sight of the Lord?
No.
We're finding that it's not a good thing to be there as a king. Now, he did what his the first king of the north did all the bad stuff. So we know that the first Jeroboam, and they're not necessarily related, but they got the same name. He, Jeroboam II, did everything that Jeroboam I did. And what was the main thing he did? The first king of the north. Well, he brought in the gods and these little gods so that the people could worship them, including Jehovah God, kind of a mixed religion. But once you mix, for instance, Christianity with any other faith, you have just destroyed your Christian faith. And that's what these kings were doing. Now, they did it for political reasons initially, to have a north and a south and have two nations. Yet, because of doing that, they disturbed the faith in God, Jehovah. And so that's what we see here. And the ironic part about this, Jeroboam II, he was probably the most successful king ever when the kingdom was divided. He brought prosperity. Now, that's a good thing, isn't it? You know, I want to be prosperous in my personal life, not only spiritually, but financially. Does anybody want to be the have no money at all here to live on? How do you live on no money? I don't know. Now, some guys can do that. Some of those guys that became missionaries and they just lived by faith. They had nothing and God took care of them. But I'm not recommending for you to do that. You work hard. You find a skill or career that will bring food to the table. And other things too. The other amenities that we so need in life. Now, King Jeroboam, number two, not the second king, but number two, like Robert G. Fletcher Jr., and I am Robert G. Fletcher Jr., I was named after my dad, and I named my son after me, and I still don't know whether he likes to be named after me yet. I have never asked him. In fact, I'm hesitant to ask him, do you like your dad's name? And not because the name is so bad, but you know, if there's some squirrely things about a relationship, you kind of, the son doesn't really necessarily want to talk about it. Or dads want to talk about everything with their sons. It's not always good. But anyway, so here we got this king. He was successful. He was able to get property or boundary, expand the boundaries of Israel. And whether it was then or now, expanding your borders is considered a good thing and a prosperous thing to do. Well, he did that. And he took back from the Syrians, the north side, where Damascus is. You would say, well, this king is a good king. In some respects, he is a good king. But then again, he is not, because he brought the gods of the pagan societies. And so, I really don't want to emphasize this king today. It is good to emphasize kings to see how they went, whether good or bad. But really, what I would like to focus in on is 2 Kings 14, and let me find it. Just one verse. Let me scan chapter 14 and we're going to get to it. Here it is. Verse 20. Anyone want to take a guess?
Six.
You're really close. You just went one phrase beyond. Verse 25. And I'm going to skip all that about Jeroboam here. Here it is. You ready? Jonah, the son of Amittai, the prophet who was of Gath Hepher. That's it. Jonah. No matter whether you have a good king or a bad king, you will always find God giving you communication in your life. No matter if you're prosperous or you have nothing in life, God sends a prophet of some kind. Maybe not necessarily a human prophet, but he will bring you prophecy in your life. And I'm not necessarily talking about prophecy foretelling the future. Prophecy that will help you, teach you where to go, what to do, and even whether you should move or not. We all need that kind of encouragement from God or the word of the Lord in your life. You really can't survive and be someone who is successful spiritually unless you have that in your life. Oh, you don't have to be a Christian to find some success. But it's not necessarily the kind of success that will get you to the point of understanding why you're even here. And to me, Jonah is the key figure when you talk about Jeroboam II. And if that's not enough, even if they aren't listed, there were other prophets that we know about that were living at this time of Jeroboam. Hosea. Joel. Not my son. Joel. He was named after Joel and the other Joel that used to go to the church. And Amos. So God didn't leave these people stranded without knowing what's going to happen. And God will not leave you stranded. He will give you understanding why you are at the place you are at, whether it's relationally or career-wise. That is significant, isn't it? At least four prophets were living at this time, somewhere in, mostly at the ending reign of Jeroboam II. Why is that significant? Well, let's start with Jonah. Why is he so important? He was a rascal, wasn't he? He was one that really didn't want to do what God told him to do that was very important. So God had a whale suck him up And he lived in the belly of a whale. Now, we're not going to talk about that, okay? Just for the fact that God had to straighten this guy out. He was going to give an important message to a group of people that would one day destroy the northern kingdom. Well, why? Why would God want to do that? And my deduction on this is that the most important thing is God wants to deliver and save everyone. Everyone. Even the worst of society. And Jonah represents that prophet who has to give that message in Nineveh. That is Assyria. Nineveh was the most important city at the time for the Assyrians. And Jonah didn't want to do that because these were evil people. And Jonah knew from past that these people wanted to destroy Israel. And so there was in Jonah's heart a self-righteousness. I am not going to give salvation and righteousness to these terrible people. These people that put in war and enemies on a spear with their head skulls visible to everybody to show how powerful they are. They skinned people alive and let them die. They didn't put them to death. They let that happen and they would just watch these people die, skinned alive. This is the kind of people that Jonah had to go to. Now, would you want to go there? I don't think so. At this moment, though, Jonah knew that the Assyrians weren't that powerful. So they couldn't do these things yet to the Israelites. But yet Jonah still didn't want to go because, man, these guys are against my faith. I don't want to even touch them. They're unclean. But it was so important that he goes because we now today can say, you know that guy over there? He's a miserable, rotten person. But God even sent Christ to save him. The God that we serve and worship is a God of salvation. He wants to save anybody and everyone. If that's not enough at this time, Hosea was living. What about Hosea? Now, he was a nice guy. He was very faithful to God. And God said, marry that prostitute. Whoa! Gomer! Hosea, I tell you what, I couldn't do that. I couldn't do what Jonah was told to do. I can't do what Hosea was told to do too. Could you marry some guy that's the worst evil guy that's sleeping around all the place or a woman that's doing the same thing? Even if you're doing that, you wouldn't want to marry someone like that, would you? I don't think so. Yet, Hosea was asked to do that by God. And sure enough, when they were married, she was sleeping around. And God said, Hosea, you will find her and bring her back. And you give her forgiveness. Because what you are going through personally is what this country is doing to me. They are committing adultery against the God of the universe. Whoa! Salvation belongs to our God, doesn't it, as we sang this morning? Oh, we haven't yet. I'm sorry, Nick. Spill the beans. That's our closing song. Salvation belongs to our God. If that's not enough, God sent Amos to them. And who's Amos? He was some farmer. Never spoke good English. He didn't say arthritis, he said arteritis. That's the kind of guy this was. He was from the country. And there's nothing wrong with that, by the way. Most of my friends are country boys. And he had to go and tell the people, and Amos, by the way, his name literally means burden. Burden. What's a burden? That's not good, is it? You got a burden, man. That's a heavy load. Donkeys have burdens, aren't they? They're the animal of burdens, aren't they? You got to put that heavy load on them to get wherever you want, and they probably ache their back. Eventually. They're tough cookies, but burdens are hard on people and nations. And God said, you're going to have a burden here. You're going to be almost destroyed, you nation. And the guys that Jonah had to go to, they're the ones that are going to do it to you. What if we, here in the U.S., we were defeated by some nation, and we were then second class? We had to do everything that nation told us to do. That's a big burden, isn't it? I wouldn't want to live in that situation. I don't think you do, too. If that's not enough, then there's Joel. Joel, and his name has that word God in there. And he's going to present to the people the day of the Lord. And that's really not a good day for a lot of people. The day of the Lord represents God coming and doing judgment on people. Okay, so we got here four prophets. A fourfold hard message, not only personally for those guys, but for the nation. But they were sent to give salvation to the people so that they could be redirected. Now, you guys that love your gaming and your computers and your cell phone, smartphones, all that. Yeah, redirection is really important, isn't it? It is. And I've gotten frustrated when I couldn't redirect my electronics. And then, of course, I go for help. Cheryl and the kids. And they get me straightened out. But God brings them for your good and for your redirection. And with that redirection, God will bring blessing. He will bring forgiveness. He will bring redemption. God's last page, no matter what century, is always about Him bringing final resolution for you, for the nation, peace in your heart and your life. That is His ultimate goal when He brings judgment.
Are you ready today to have that if you don't have it? You can have it. His word tells us that. If you can find the prophet in your life at this moment, it's a good thing. It's not based about what we see, what our eyes can see around us, and what we see at work, and the disappointments and the discouragement. It's not about that. God is going to give you the right kind of vision. He's going to give you the right understanding of His word so that you may see correctly. He'll bring resolve to your life. It never fails. Never. And I promise you, because of what He promises, it will turn out good. And you and I will see really what salvation is all about. Because salvation originates from our God. Salvation belongs to our God. Nick, Carl, Tim.
Who sits upon the your salvation today and from here on. God bless you all. Thanks for coming. Have a great rest of the weekend. You are dismissed.